Good morning.
Good morning.
We were having a little bit of technical difficulties, and we didn't want to get started before the rest of the country could be a part of this morning service. First of all, I want to thank all of you guys for all your prayers. Last week we mentioned, or I mentioned, that my husband had a stroke and a brain bleed. They did not say it was a stroke, and I can't remember the terminology they used, but he's doing a lot better. He was transferred to an acute rehabilitation hospital in Scottsdale. So keep your prayers coming. We appreciate it, and I know God is hearing us. We have with us today Mother Christine. Thank you, Mother Christine, for coming. And as she always say, whenever we need her, she's available, she will be here for us. So I say each week how blessed we are that we're able to, every week since a vicar left, that we had someone who will come so we could do the Holy Eucharist. In my mind, church is not church without the Eucharist. And we are able to do that all the time. But we will be having some good news soon. So just keep praying, just keep hoping, and know that God is working for our plan. Those of you who are out there viewing us on your computer, we welcome you. We ask you to ready yourself as we prepare to worship and give thanks to God.
and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
O Lord, your love endures forever.
Do not abandon the works of your hands.
The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12, still alive. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me, for I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
with their own weakness, their sinfulness, and with a sense of unworthiness. Our first reading, in Isaiah, he has a majestic vision of God sitting on the heavenly throne. Isaiah is frightened by this vision of the glory of God. God's awesome holiness causes him to recognize his sinfulness. He cries out, "Woe is me, for I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Even the greatest prophet in Hebrew text, Moses, veils his face when he is in the presence of God. It is an understanding in the Old Testament that the infinite, all-powerful God, glory and presence, will overwhelm the frail, limited human and likely lead to death. And Isaiah is overwhelmed by the vast gulf between God, who is holy, sacred otherness, and his lowly and sinful state. In our gospel reading, Peter at first resists Jesus' invitation to let down his fishing net, knowing that it is pointless, as he and the others were out all night and caught nothing. He gives in to Jesus' request to lower the net. As they fill to bursting, seeing the great catch of fish, he is confronted with the power of God present in Jesus. His response is to recognize his sinfulness. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." Peter is both amazed and fearful of the power of God in Jesus. And we have Paul in the letter to the Corinthians, who knows his sinfulness. He was a persecutor of the early followers of Jesus, and yet was called and answered the call to be an apostle. He says, "For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God." And yet he goes on to say, "But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace toward me has not been in vain. So we proclaim, and so you have come to believe." Isaiah, Peter, and Paul, though confronted by their sinfulness, are not left to wallow in self-pity, but rather were made aware in this state of humility of God's call to them. Isaiah receives a sign of forgiveness first. "Then one of the seraphs flew to me, holding a live coal that had been taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. The seraph touched my mouth with it and said, 'Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed and your sin is blotted out.'" This sign of forgiveness may make it easier to respond to the call because he does not hesitate. "Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, 'Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?' And I said, 'Here am I, send me.'" Peter, along with James and John, are called by Jesus to catch people rather than fish. And we're told that when they had brought their boats to shore, they left everything and followed him. I'm often struck by these disciples' response to the call Jesus presents them. They left everything and followed him. And Isaiah, who boldly says, "Here I am, send me." My own response to God's call was a bit less enthusiastic. Sometimes it's hard to trace when you first hear a specific call from God. There were perhaps signs that in hindsight I recognized. Yet the first time I actually heard or conceived that I was being called to be a priest, I didn't believe it. I was at a church that my husband's family had attended for many years when he was young, and we spent time there as well. A couple of times, that was our parish church. It's called St. Mark's in the Bowery. And the song that we heard as a prelude, "Here I Am, Lord," was being played and being sung. And as I sang that, I thought, "God wants me to be a priest." And I said, "Bah." I said to Dan, know, I keep thinking maybe I have a call to be a priest. You know, we've been on Crucio, which is a way of getting more in touch with your faith, deepening that faith. You know, it's a wonderful 3-day weekend that really can inspire people. And I said to him, doesn't everybody who goes on Crucio want to be a priest? He said, no. But I was working full time. I had school-aged children at home. You need a bachelor's degree in order to go, and I didn't have one. I had done the core requirements when I was younger and then left and had a family. But after Crucio, I started seeing a spiritual director. And I talked to her a number of times about the sense of call. And she said to me, after a time, it's been 6 years, Christine. I don't think the question is whether you have a call. The question is, what is your answer? Mm-hmm. And boy, when she said that, it fell back to me, and I said, here I am, Lord. That sense of unworthiness doesn't fully go away. Even if your rector affirms your call, and the Commission on Ministry does as well, or even when the bishop says yes. Prior to my ordination, it's traditional to go and have confession. And I thought, I'm going to do this right. I had a copy of St. Augustine's prayer book, and in it is a guide for confession. And it has this outline, rather lengthy outline. So I took that outline, and I sat down and said, suggestion, make notes. And I wrote like 4 pages of notes on how to send the letters. And I went to my confessors, where I had been to confession before, Brother Clark, Franciscan at Little Portion Friary at the time, they moved now to San Francisco. He said to me, Christy, I'm sure God appreciates your thoroughness. Heaven and God has called you just as you are. And I thought, the response to a call from God may take a profound sense of being given. Excuse me. I need a little water for a minute. I can tell. I'm hoping that I don't. The response to a call from God may take a profound sense of being forgiven, like with Isaiah. Or just the knowledge that God accepts me for who I am. But the encouragement of the community of believers, those who are ordained and those who are not, is often the only way any of us can say yes. The Corinthians had answered the call when Paul first came to them. But he is now concerned that they are straying, that their belief and trust is weakening. He says to them, I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved. If you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. Some in the church have come to doubt the resurrection. He has to remind them of the core of his proclamation. He says Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, and then the 12. Paul is exhorting them to remain faithful to the call of the good news. He credits God's grace within that enabled him to be an apostle, even if the last or the lowliest of the first apostles. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace toward me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is within me. By the grace of God, we all are who we are. Each of us has been given grace by God in baptism, and most have been strengthened through confirmation. Sometimes when confronted with the awesomeness, the perfection of God's love, we may recognize our weakness and experience a sense of unworthiness before the Holy God. But the grace but by the grace of God, we are who we are. God's love makes each of us worthy. It shows us that we are worthy, we are valued, we are part of something bigger and greater than ourselves. God's love calls us and prepares us to love in ways beyond what we thought we were capable. We gather together in community like the Corinthians did, and like Paul, we encourage and uphold each other in our various calls. Each call is lived out in unique ways. We are all part of God's daunting task laid before the church, given to each of us at baptism. We are called simply to save the world. Called to share in God's loving action in Jesus, to redeem and to love into wholeness all the people and all of creation. By God's grace, we are who we are. God's love and grace ensure that we are worthy and fit for the great call of love. We need merely to open our hearts to Him, and He will open our hearts to others.
After each night, the people who offer prayers, either silently or aloud. Let us pray for the revealing of the reign of God in the world now and always. In the beginning, God was,
here and now, for our days. beginning.
Creator of earth, sea, and sky, kindle the fire of your spirit within us, that you may be bold to hear and defend the earth. Pour your blessings upon all who work for the good of the planet. God, giver of life,
hear our prayer.
Breathe life, receive our thanks for the beauty of all habitant and all who dwell in, and grant us the wisdom and will to conserve it.
God, giver of life, hear our prayer.
Source of life, heal and redeem the wounds of your creation, places, and people who suffer from indifference, neglect, and greed. God,
giver of life,
hear our prayer. Lover of all you have made, we thank you for your wondrous diversity of your creatures, and we pray for their well-being. God,
giver of life,
hear our prayer. Author of the book of nature, receive our gratitude for places of restoration, healing. Continue to bless those places that feed our lives and spirits. God,
giver of life, hear our prayer.
Wise creature, whose works are full of mystery, give us wonder and ask for it, appreciation for the creatures with whom we find ourselves in conflict. God,
giver of life,
hear our prayer. Giver of all goods, gifts, awaken us daily to our dependence upon your bounty, and make us always thankful for the abundance of your blessings. God,
giver of life,
hear our prayer. Divine physician, heal our communities, especially those who are neglect, greed, and violence, inflict suffering upon people and other nations, other creatures. God,
hear our life,
hear our prayer. Comfort all the earth, sustain the people of this congregation who desire and need your presence and help. We pray for Michelle, Ronnie Gilbert, Ron, Reverend Jean, Kira, Sharon, Bertram, Billy, Barbara, Gail, Noodles, Floyd, Katie, Ray, Kathy, Ethel, Frankie, Alden, Teresa, Suzanne, Cooper, Arnold, Lulu, Cheryl, Joan, Audrey, Andy, Jill, Beth, Alex, Emmy, Jim, Debbie, Terry, Sandra, Sharon, Joni, Larry, Cynthia, Charles, Sandra. God, giver of life,
hear our prayer.
Father of the book of nature, receive our gratitude for places, restoration, and healing. Continue to bless those places that feed our lives and spirits. God,
giver of life, hear our prayer.
Wise creator, whose works are full of mystery, give us wonder and appreciation for the creatures with whom we find ourselves in conflict. God,
hear our life,
hear our prayer. Cover all the earth and sustain the people this covenant. Excuse me, sorry about that. God and refuge of all your creatures, receive our everlasting mercy for those who have died. Repose the soul, Kathy, Clay, Cordelia, Terry, Jerry. God,
giver of life, hear our prayer.
May we always come to share our heavenly kingdom, the people may adjourn your own petition or petitions. We praise you for your spirits who have entered into joy. Help us honor the knowledge of our indigenous neighbors, to listen through them in their call to renew the life of earth and to live together as your people. Lord, have mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God, accept the fervent prayers of your people, and the multitude of your mercies look with compassion upon us, and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious and loving souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins for our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
I wanted to reassure everyone that I've been vaccinated and boosted, but allergies don't go away just because COVID is in the house.
You and I know it.
I know Mother Christine is vaccinated because she told me way before now when I called her and the first offset of COVID, I'm not coming if we don't have vaccination. So I know she's vaccinated. So we don't have to worry about that. And I'm vaccinated too, fully vaxxed. Once again, welcome. Thank you for being here. Last week we had Bishop Jennifer who said to us that we were evangelists. Last week the church was rocking. People showed up because we went out and asked them to come. So we need to continue to be evangelists. We don't have to go on the street corner with a bullhorn, but we can tell them who Jesus is. And like Mother Christine said, when she received her call to be a priest, we all receive calls, we all hear things. I got a beautiful card this morning from one of our parishioners, and it was really personalized. And I didn't know that people listened to what I said in the morning. But she did write on the card how appreciative she is for us, for me, and the little church with the big heart in the desert. And she put with beads a church, a little church. So thank you for doing that. That's when I cried, because of the love that you have. Those of you who are leaders in the community in this church, I'd like for you to get your report ready. We are planning to have the annual parish meeting on the 27th of this month, when our junior ward will be here in person. The meeting will be in person and online, so come prepare with your questions. We are working on the budget now, so if you have not turned in your pledge card, it's not too late. I will meet with David this afternoon and we will do the pledge so we could do a budget to get to the bishop, because the bishop has, they're looking at someone to come to us. But we need to know who we can afford, what we can afford. So the budget needs to be done, and then I will send it to the bishop, and the bishop will go over those. So we are looking real good. Prayers are working. Keep your faith. We are going to have someone. But again, if you did not turn in your pledge card, it's not too late to do so. I ask you to continue to follow us on www.stpeterseepiscopalcg.org on Tuesday evening for evening prayer, on Thursday evening for compline, both at 6 o'clock in the evening. When Jenna was here, we felt a little bad because we do our evening prayer and we do a compline, and then we go back and look, maybe nobody looked at it. We go back later. But the part is that we are still proclaiming the gospel through the airways. So we don't care if nobody watches, we are going to do it anyway. But we asked you to go so we could have some numbers on there. We have to do the parochial report. It's due on 13th of March, I believe. And on there, I need to be able to put on there how many people is watching us online. So if you want to go so we could have some numbers, that would be good too. Karen?
Good morning. I just want to remind the members of the outreach committee that we have a meeting this Tuesday in Burton Hall at 10 o'clock. We're going to be discussing Laundry Love and some changes that are happening with Laundry Love right now. And also wanted to let you know that my generous neighbor picked a lot of lemons off her lemon tree and gave them to me because she said, I'd like these to go to your church members. There's a box of lemons in the narthex, and there's some bags there, so help yourself.
Are we doing birthdays?
Birthdays.
Or anniversaries? Any travel happening?
Ascribe unto the Lord the honor of his name. Bring offerings and come to his courts.
Normally, we see a little handout for the gift bank. We would like you all to sing with us when we do our offertory hymn.
Thank you.
Thanksgiving Eucharistic Prayer A. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Because of the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused a new light to shine in our hearts to give the knowledge of your glory in the face of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Therefore, let us keep the peace. Alleluia.
The
the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
The folks to the executive on page 9 of your booklet. Let us pray. God of abundance, you have fed us with the bread of life and the cup of salvation. You have united us with Christ and one another, and you have made us one, all of you in heaven and on earth. Now send us forward in the power of your Spirit, that we may be clear that we give you love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Christ our Savior. Amen. Go forth into the world in peace, be of good courage, hold fast to that which is true. Render no one evil for evil, support the weak, strengthen the faint-hearted, help the afflicted, honor all people, love and serve the Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you all forever. Amen.
Amen.
Who was the first black Episcopal priest that was ordained. So, and I will be doing a reading on his legacy. So this is why I'm in my chapter.
That's beautiful. Yes, it is.
Thank you. Beautiful. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.